In this part, I want to assess the current state of the realism debate by developing the view that the debate has shifted now from a distinction between observable and unobservable entities to a distinction within the unobservables. So I call this current state of play an attempt to raise epistemic dichotomies where there are only epistemic continua. These are attempts to draw a sharp epistemic dichotomy between those aspects of nature that are knowable and those that will remain secret. Attempts to circumscribe realms of being that are cognitively impenetrable to us, to set limits to our knowledge of nature. The tone was set by Kant. The things as they are in themselves remain forever hidden to the human intellect, bound as it is by sensible intuition. Being minded as we are forecloses the possibility of getting epistemic access to the noumena. Knowledge, at least the sort of knowledge licensed by the theoretical reason, according to Kant, is always knowledge of the appearances which are constituted by the forms of pure intuition, space and time, and the schematized categories of the understanding. Note, however, that Kant's epistemic dichotomy was horizontal. The appearances are not just observable phenomena. Conversely, the things as they are in themselves would remain unknowable even if the whole of nature was revealed to us. Current epistemically dichotomous positions are mixed, from strong non-realists to weak realists, and they are by and large vertical. There is something epistemically suspicious with the unobservable, and that's the non-realist view, or some aspects of the unobservable, that's the weak realist view. Constructive empiricism takes it that the epistemic dichotomy is drawn quite sharply along the line observable-unobservable. The issue is said to be one between full truth, which is inaccessible, and truth about the appearances, in Van Frassen's sense and not in Kant's, which is accessible at least in principle. Then we've got structural realism of the epistemic stripe. Here the epistemic dichotomy is between knowing the structure of nature and knowing whatever is left to fill out the structure. This is an epistemic dichotomy among bits of the unobservable world, its structure versus its non-structure. Hence, this is a weak realist view. It allows some knowledge of the unobservable. But if we dig deeper, then this distinction, of course, can be contested. There is entity realism. Here, the epistemic dichotomy is between knowing entities and perhaps some of their properties and knowing the truth of fundamental theories. Here again, the dichotomy is drawn within the realm of the unobservable. Another dichotomy is issued recently by Kyle Stanford, a philosopher of science who develops a new instrumentalist position. According to him, the epistemic dichotomy is between those entities to which there is an independent route of epistemic access, mediated by theories which cannot be subjected to serious doubt, and those entities to which all supposed epistemic access is mediated by high-level theories. Stanford takes it that the former are epistemically accessible, while the latter are cognitively impenetrable. High-level theories are taken to be useful conceptual tools for guiding action rather than maps of an unavailable to the senses reality. Here again, however, the dichotomy is drawn within the realm of the unobservable. There is this position that was developed by another philosopher of science, Jody Azzouni. The epistemic dichotomy here is between knowing whatever we have thick access to and whatever there is only thick epistemic access, that is via the confirmation of scientific theories. Here the dichotomy is drawn within the realm of the unobservable again. It's instrument-based tracking of the properties of unobservables, which makes their knowledge possible, while theory-mediated access to them via the confirmation of theories leaves them cognitively inaccessible. Finally, there is semi-realism, a view developed by Anjan Chakravarti. Here the epistemic dichotomy is between detection properties and auxiliary properties of particular entities. According to Chakravarti, there is epistemic access only to the parts of theories which can be interpreted as referring to a certain class of properties of concrete causal structure, that is, detection properties. Detection properties are contrasted to auxiliary properties. These are attributed to particulars by theories, but there is no reason to believe in their reality since they are not detected, though they might be detectable and become detected later on. Note that from epistemic structural realism and beyond, or below if you like, all positions make the dichotomy within the realm of the unobservable. Therefore, they allow that there is epistemic access to some unobservable part of reality. So all these are weak realist or weak anti-realist, if you like, positions, with Chakravartis being the strongest realist among them. The key position now is that some knowledge of the unobservable is deemed possible, and I think that's a victory for realism. Imagine where this debate started. The question is the dichotomy between the epistemically accessible unobservable and the epistemically inaccessible one strict, sharp, robust, principled, and the like? The common denominator of all this position is that there is a principled division between what can be known of nature and what cannot. So there is a principled limit to the scientific knowledge of the world. The realist reaction, which I have defended, is that there is no good reason, either a priori or a posteriori, to think that there is a principled epistemic division between what can be known of nature and what cannot. There might be parts of nature that science might never be able to map out, but these do not fall nicely within a conceptual category which captures one side of a sharp epistemic dichotomy. The unknown X, the noumena, the non-structure, the intrinsic properties, the auxiliary properties, whatever there is only thin epistemic access to, whatever there is only theory-mediated access to, and the like. The argument for this, unfortunately, is book length, and I've developed it in my own work on scientific realism.